Good morning and a warm welcome to the 17th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. Our first agenda item is declaration of interest as a result of membership change. Can I welcome George Adam, MSP, to the committee and can I invite you to declare any relevant interests?
No relevant interests, convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Adam. Second agenda item is to a decision on taking business in private. Are members content to consider the draft reports on the national outcomes and the review of the EU-UK Trade and Cooperation Agreement inquiry in private at future meetings? Agreed. Thank you very much. Our third agenda item is to take evidence on the committee's inquiry on the review of the EU-UK Trade and Cooperation Agreement, and we're joined online this morning by Angus Robertson, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, and he is joined by Frank Strang, Deputy Director, European Relations, and Nick Leek, Deputy Director, EU Office in the Scottish Government. And could I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement?
A very good morning, convener and committee members. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee today and to exchange views on implementation of the Trade and Cooperation Agreement, which has been an important focus of the Scottish Government's work since the agreement came to force on the 1st of May 2021. Also very much welcome that the committee has undertaken such a wide-ranging inquiry into the treaty's implementation and heard evidence from such a wide range of witnesses. From the evidence you've taken so far, it's clear that the Scottish Government's priorities coincide in very many cases with the priorities of stakeholders in business, in education and in civil society. It's been a large part of our work in recent months to interact with as many stakeholders as we can, such as the UK Domestic Advisory Group and the Scottish Advisory Forum on Europe. We are very keen to make sure that we hear what they say and gather evidence from their expertise. It's particularly timely for you to be carrying out this work at present, since we expect the review provided for in the agreement to take place in 25-26. Though it's not yet clear whether that may lead to consideration of substantive changes, and the elections this year in both the European Union and the UK may also lead to new scenarios and opportunities for improvement. Turning first to the big picture, the Scottish Government strongly affirms that Scotland shares the EU's vision of peace and cooperation. The founding principles of the European project are universal and rooted in a belief in human dignity and freedom expressed through democracy. And we also share Europe's global challenges, and we're determined to work together on shared solutions. The war in Ukraine, the conflict in Gaza, the continuing threat of climate change make the scale of global challenges very clear. Scotland voted clearly to remain in the European Union, with majorities for Remain in every local authority area in the country. And despite that clear democratic expression, the UK government's hard Brexit has been imposed upon us, leading to so many of the difficulties which your inquiry has already brought to light. It's welcome that we've seen a modest improvement in recent months to the EU-UK relationship. It's overwhelmingly in Scotland's interests for there to be a much more positive and mutually beneficial relationship between the EU and UK, and we'll do our part to help create that where we can. As you know, the Scottish Government is committed to maintaining alignment with the European Union where such alignment is possible and meaningful in protecting and advancing the high standards that we share. We continue to be proactive and constructive participants in EU matters by engaging closely with TCA fora, but also through our wider engagement with EU institutions and member states through an active network of international offices, through supporting inward visits here at home. In April, for example, I had the pleasure of welcoming the EU ambassador to Scotland for a busy programme of engagement with Scottish stakeholders. And the Scottish Government is thereby doing everything that it can to mitigate the damage of a Brexit that Scotland didn't vote for, minimise divergence with the EU and ease Scotland's eventual return. Let me now turn to the priorities that the Scottish Government has identified in its work around the TCA, after which I hope we can discuss our respective approaches to the challenges that we see. Let me focus for a moment on the higher education sector, so crucial to Scotland's economy, society and reputation. Scotland benefited disproportionately from the Horizon Europe and Erasmus Plus programmes. And we're pleased that in January this year, the UK finally associated to the Horizon Europe programme collaborating internationally is vital for our education and research institutions, and the Scottish Government has continually urged the UK Government to find a pathway back to Horizon. And now we need to ensure that we maximise Scottish participation in the programme, and I'm pleased that work on this has already begun. One of the fundamental rights in the EU, that of free movement, offered unique opportunities to our young people while we were in the EU, and the Erasmus Plus programme was a key element of this, and we've been strongly urging the UK Government to reassociate to the programme. We also welcome the recent proposal of the EU Commission to open negotiations with the UK Government on youth mobility, and I can only hope that this issue will receive fresh consideration after the UK election. In summary, there are many other issues the committee has already heard about, which the Scottish Government also sees as important priorities. These include an SPS agreement and other trade easements, enhanced mobility arrangements for services and creative professionals, and electricity trading and wider energy cooperation, where Scotland's hydrogen sector has so much to offer. There's no doubt that we have the technical knowledge to address all of these issues. What we need is a change in mindset, moving to a place of trust where we can do real business together. Look forward to discussing these issues with you and other matters that members may wish to raise.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. If I could open with a question regarding the evidence from businesses that we have heard during the inquiry, all of whom were expressing a structural disadvantage in exporting to the EU in terms of added cost and time involved. And it became clear that the larger exporters, larger organisations were much better placed to be able to absorb those costs than small to medium enterprises that we also met with and visited. Scots Whisky Association told us it's much easier for companies if they know what the requirements are, even if there's a bit of a burden in that. If the product lands at a port in the EU and is held while people run around trying to find a document that has been asked for, which they were not expecting, those issues, while reducing, have not completely gone away for exporters. So the Scottish Government is limited when it comes to the workings of the TCE and its review, but what are you and agencies such as SDI doing to support Scottish business, particularly small to medium enterprises, in the ways and in trading with Europe, and what ways has your approach changed since the TCA came into play?
So, I mean, I think the first thing to state is the obvious, and you've heard this from those who've given evidence to you already. The TCA is a significant step backwards in our economic and trading relationship with the European Union compared to the benefits that the UK enjoyed as a member state. The evidence that you've heard in the inquiry has illustrated this already. Brexit has generated bureaucracy, it's generated costs, it's generated delays, and it's created complexity for Scottish businesses. There are barriers to trade. These are they've exacerbated recruitment challenges. They've held back investment. And the scale of this is significant. The UK economy is now 2.5% smaller than it would have been in the EU. And the gap, which could increase to 5.7% by 2035. Now, there are things that can be done, and these are things that Scottish Enterprise, the national economic agency of the Scottish Government, deal with, as does Scottish Development International, as do our colleagues in the Scottish Government office in Brussels. There's constantly an effort to try and work out how can we ameliorate these challenges. But there's only so much that can be done. Our relations with the European Union are a matter for the UK government. The UK government has sought a hard Brexit. We now have a hard Brexit, and we have the hard consequences. And we will do what we can around the edges, and that's maybe we'll come on to that in discussion about the TCA. What can we do with very specific examples where there may be slight improvements that can be sought? But in terms of the big picture, unless the UK seeks to rejoin the European single market or seeks to join the European Union as a whole, we are going to continue with all of these disadvantages. And we will work together with business, with exporters, with importers as much as we can. But there's no getting around the hard facts. Brexit is Brexit. It's bad, and it will continue to be bad.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to move to questions from committee members. I'll bring in Mr. Ruskell first.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. So I wanted to ask you about regulatory alignment with the European Union. I mean, regulations very rarely stay still. You know, they often change, evolve over time. But now we're out of the room in the European Union. We're no longer part of that process of developing and improving regulations anymore. And I'm just wondering if you think that perhaps there's now the potential for more of a kind of a UK consensus on regulation, and is there a possibility that might then diverge from European Union standards and regulations?
Well, it's very much a moving target. There are certain things where it would make real sense for the UK to align itself with European standards. To give you a current example of that, energy is an example, where Scotland's significant potential for renewable energy and the export of that as either electricity or as hydrogen-related products, ammonia, hydrogen itself. These are things which require regulatory agreement with the European Union, and that currently does not exist at the present time. And so we, as the Scottish Government, are needing to impress on UK government colleagues in the current and probably outgoing government, and hopefully those in a likely incoming UK government are listening, that we require regulatory agreement and alignment on this issue so that we can reach our full potential. We're not in the room. We are having to ask others to act on our behalf. They may or may not. They may have other things which are a higher priority. But I'm doing everything that I can to communicate to decision makers in London, in Brussels, and in EU national capitals, particularly those that have an interest in the likes of energy importation, so that would be Berlin, that with goodwill, we could be in a win-win situation. But if anything, this underlines why not being in the room is a disadvantage. Because if we are to use the TCA mechanism, which we will, because it's all we have as a formal structure, is that I will have an occasional meeting with a junior minister in the Foreign Office, as has been the case up until now, who will sit and listen and will say that they are hearing what we are saying and then may or may not act. And then we are able to observe, and I've sat in on meetings with Maro Sefcovic and the last UK Foreign Secretary, and seen some issues raised that we impressed on the UK government that we thought were important, and then others which were not. So we're going through a number of stages of things may be listened to, they may be heard, they might be acted on, but they may very well not be. And so we are beholden to others acting on our behalf, and them having a goodwill and understanding that this may be a good thing. So, I mean, we may come on to this further in the evidence session. We had a recent example of a proposal around the reintroduction of free movement for younger people.
I think we'll come on to that a bit later.
We'll
come on to that a bit later. And I think you raise a good example of where there's common interest in aligning with European Union regulations. I suppose what I'm interested in, though, is about the Scottish Government's position of maintaining alignment within the EU and how that may differ from a UK position. So if I can give you an example, there's an essay coming to the Parliament next week on persistent organic pollutants, which the EU is looking to phase out, but they're looking to phase it out on a very strict timescale, phasing out the pollutants by 2027. I think the UK and the Scottish Government position is to take a slightly weaker regulatory approach and to not phase out these chemicals by 2027. So a clear area where a niche bit of environmental policy, but the Scottish Government's taking a position to not align with EU policy on that. Now, I'm not asking you to comment on the merits of that. We'll come to that, I'm sure, next week in Parliament. But is it an example of where perhaps all that regulatory development work is being done within the UK? It's about agencies, regulators working together with industry, but because that's not involving the European Union, the potential for divergence is there, and that's a clear area that's being presented to Parliament next week, where if it's passed, there will be divergence with the EU. So I don't know if you understand my point there.
I do understand the point you're making.
So I just wanted, because I think that's something this committee has looked at a number of times about, yes, there's a desire to stay broadly aligned, but there could also be a creeping divergence where you're just not in the room in the European Union, so you're not really part of that consensus about how regulatory policy can develop further.
So the first thing that I would say, and we have a colleague who's, who is virtually joining me, who is in the front line of this in Brussels. We have an office in Brussels which works with European institutions to, as far as is possible, be aware of European Union regulations and proposals. And we look across the piece at those, and we try, as far as is possible, to work in a way that we can maintain our alignment with the European Union. You'll have to forgive me that when you'll appreciate that there are hundreds and hundreds of different proposals that are brought forward. So you've not invited me to speak about the specific issue, which will be discussed more next week. But just in the generality, the Scottish Government, its office in Brussels, and our agencies are working with a view to remain as closely aligned as we can, and that we do not see significant divergence between Scotland and the European Union. That is the aim of the Scottish Government. There will be examples where that is not the case, but in terms of the generality and the direction of travel, that is the policy of the government, and we're doing as much as we can. And I think Mr. Ruskell and others on the committee will be aware we have been working closely with the clerks of the committee to make sure that members can be informed about how that is done, and that there's a reporting mechanism to Parliament about alignment as well. So it's a work in progress, but we want to make sure that the committee and parliamentarians are informed as much as possible about those alignment efforts.
Did you want to bring your official in? Did you want to bring your official in as well, Mr. Robertson?
Sorry, Nick, would you like to add something?
Is that working?
Yeah.
Brilliant. Sorry, I was on mute before. Yeah, so just to support what Cabinet Secretary says, really, I mean, the EU legislative process starts at the beginning of a new five-year cycle, and you can see that the new five-year cycle has started now, when the Commission President, who we think will be appointed at the end of this month, sets out her guidelines. The next thing we'll see is a work programme that the Commission will produce at the end of this year or the beginning of next year, which will set out the legislation that they will propose over the year to come. And we try and track those as they come through. Our best chance of influencing those proposals is before the Commission has made them. So we talk to people about that at that stage as well. But once the Commission's made a proposal, we try and track it all through Parliament and Council. But as Cabinet Secretary says, there's a heck of a lot. And so we're doing our best to get on top of it as much as possible.
But is that not very high level? So when we come down to individual laws and a choice about whether to align with the EU or not, where are you within the policy process within that? Because it seems to me that what's happening right now is you're sitting down with UK counterparts and you're making a decision about whether you stay aligned or not on very specific pieces of legislation. So I'm interested in how you're also talking to EU Commission about your aspirations around alignment and how you might stay aligned and how you bring those into those four nation discussions within the UK about regulations and change. Frank Strang, did you want to come in on that?
Can I come in? Can you hear me?
Yeah, can hear you fine.
Hello, Mr. Ruskell. Just very briefly, it's a good question. It's going to be a question over time. The only thing I would say would be a couple of things. One would be, it's not just about quantity, how many regulations. It's what matters most. This is about standards. So focusing on where the standards really matter to us That helps us choose, if you know what I mean. We're not just ticking boxes. We are ticking boxes, but we're also thinking about what's the important things that matter in terms of standards. And the other thing I just wanted to say, it's often good to think about the dog that doesn't bark, if that's the way to put it. So I think you've retained EU law, and I'm thinking of the sunset clause. So just since we last spoke, I guess, our ability working. So we were pretty active on that, I have to say, down in Westminster, trying to help remove the sunset clause, which was there. So you're absolutely right, Mr. Ruskell, but it could be a whole lot worse in terms of an automatic. It could be a whole more automatic removal of EU law if we hadn't managed to avoid that.
Okay. I was going to briefly move on then to Horizon, if that's okay, Cabinet Secretary. And it was good to understand that, you know, Scottish Government will now be promoting the opportunities that can come from the Horizon programme. I was wondering if you could just say a little bit more about what that will involve. Is it about working with higher education sector? Is it about, you know, Scottish Government showing leadership with particular research institutes and trying to sort of galvanise potential projects that could come through Horizon? Or I'm interested in the roadshow, I guess, and what is being planned.
So what I would have to say is firstly, that having called for the longest of times for the UK government to rejoin Horizon, I should say, incidentally, and maybe we'll come on to this, also do the same with Erasmus Plus, also do the same with Creative Europe. This has now moved very much into the academic and research space, as Mr. Ruskell has already identified. And I must confess, that is not my area of responsibility in government. I do appreciate, as I think he does and committee members, how important this is to the university sector. But I think that that's something that my education and higher education colleagues will be in a much stronger position to answer. I know it's been taken very seriously. The opportunities are very significant. And I know, having spoken to university administrators, such as Edinburgh University, how much they welcome a return to the Horizon project actually is. And it underlines our view that it's necessary to continue that process by rejoining Erasmus Plus and Creative Europe.
Okay.
Thank you. Can I move to questions from Mr. Alexander?
Thank you.
Mr. Stewart, sorry.
Thank you very much, Deputy Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning, Mr. Stewart.
You touched on your opening statement about the challenges that are faced, and as you identified, we have seen and met with a number of organisations, agencies and businesses during this inquiry. And they have talked about the navigation of trying to deal with some of the challenges and how adapted they've become to try and manage the situation. It has been difficult, there's no doubt of that. We've heard from various sectors, as I say, how they've had to change and adapt to ensure that they can navigate through the difficulties that they've found. Mm. But many of them have managed to do that because of the response and support. So it would be useful to ask you, Cabinet Secretary, how the Scottish Government and its agencies have been supporting exporting businesses to navigate the new trading arrangements themselves with the EU to see if the balance that, and the equilibrium that they're trying to find has been supported and continue to be supported by the agencies and the Scottish Government.
So the first thing I would say is that Scottish Government agencies will always do whatever they can to try and help support the Scottish export sector. The responsibility for the UK border regime is the UK government. And the government that has the responsibility for policing, literally, border arrangements, is the UK government. And this is a very clear example of where we will try what we can to ameliorate the problems. And so, Scottish Enterprise, Scottish Development International, Scottish government agencies, and the Scottish government itself, which regularly meets with representative organisations and exporting companies, will do what we can to try and make sure that there is a removal of unnecessary red tape or barriers to trade. and so on. We will do everything that we can. A good example of that, one of the biggest prizes, short of rejoining the single market, short of rejoining the European Union, would be to have a comprehensive SPS agreement. I know it's acronym soup and it's technical language, but in effect, what this would mean, it's what's known in common jargon as a veterinary agreement. And my understanding is that it would reduce the necessity of about 90% of checks, cross-border checks, were there to be such a thing. Now, I think I'm right in believing that the current and outgoing UK government does not agree that there should be an SPS agreement. And my hope is, and this has been communicated publicly, that were there to be a new and different UK government, that one should aim for an SPS agreement, a veterinary agreement, which would make it much, much easier for export and import. So, I mean, in short order, Mr. Stewart, the responsibility for hard Brexit, for borders, for Brexit red tape, is the UK government's. They own it. They've delivered it. They said it would be an improvement. It's not. We will do everything that we can, but it will only ever be at the margins to reduce the damage of Brexit. The only way that we can obviate it is to rejoin the single market in the European Union. That is, and everything else is going to make a marginal difference. We're outside the European Union now, and that means the barriers are there, and nothing will change that short of rejoining the single market and or the European Union, and I'm in favour of both.
Thank you, President.
Thank you. Can I bring in Mr. Brown and then I'll bring in Mr. Bibby?
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned the evidence that this committee has heard over some of its inquiries, and at various points we've heard about jobs being lost, businesses going bust virtually overnight or stopping exporting, in some cases being taken over by now parent companies in other countries, including Germany. We've also been told, I forget the chap's name, but a guy from, I think, Northern Ireland, who said that the UK was becoming the most expensive place in the world to do business. We've also heard from witnesses saying it's now easier to do business with North Korea than it is to do with the EU. Now, given all these impacts of Brexit, and given what you said about in a couple of weeks' time, I think most people would assume we're looking at a different UK government. Have you got a prepared list of asks for them? And I know, before you say it again, that these will only be at the margins, but there are things which can be done which would improve the situation both for people in Scotland and for businesses. So do you have, given the fact it will be whoever's elected, a fresh set of eyes coming onto this from Westminster, a list of early demands and requests that you think can help improve things in Scotland?
So, yes, the Scottish Government has been making preparatory work for a potential change of government, and it is prudent to do so. And that will include, unsurprisingly, a list of improvements that are reachable. And so those do include rejoining Erasmus Plus for educational cooperation, rejoining Creative Europe for cultural cooperation, reaching agreement with the European Union on a mobility agreement. We saw a recent proposal from the Commission that that should be reintroduced, and for essentially a reset on relations with the EU. There have been some straws in the wind that a changed UK government may take a different view. We saw this week commentary around chemical regulations as an example, where the UK Labour Party suggested that they were prepared to take a different view on things. And we will be making the case very strongly that a reset of relations with the European Union is a high priority for the Scottish Government. But to underline the point that Mr. Brown has made, these are still, in the round, only going to impact on the margins of our relations with the European Union. UK will not be in the room, will not be at the table, will not be co-determining European policies, and the UK will remain outside the single market and will continue to operate in a Brexit and a hard Brexit environment. That is the policy of the UK Labour Party as well as the UK Conservative Party. So I would not want people to get their hopes up that there will be a massive reset such that the barriers to trade will be reduced. In some respects, we run the risk that some of them will actually be heightened, because the UK government has yet to implement its border regime in its entirety. That has not yet happened. We don't have clarity yet from the Labour Party whether they would do so. If they did, I think we can look at other additional problems in relation to our trade with the European single market. In relation to Northern Ireland, we already have evidence that their situation, being able to operate within the UK single market as well as the European single market, is to their benefit. Traders in Northern Ireland have seen exports grow not only to the United Kingdom, not only to the Republic of Ireland, but to the European Union as well. And so they are able to benefit from, and I think I'm quoting even the UK Prime Minister here and his predecessors, saying they have the best of all worlds. Unfortunately, Scotland does not.
Yeah, the only thing I would say is I understand the point that there is no prospect of an incoming UK government looking again at Brexit. In fact, I think the Labour Party has now said it will never return to the EU. However, I think it's still incumbent on the Scottish Government to make as much progress as is possible, even though I can see that it's at the margins. And I just wonder, in relation to what's often called soft power, I remember being embraced physically by a senior member of the CDU in Berlin once, who said, we like our Scottish friends, they don't want to leave us. And I think people have underestimated the extent to which the personal affront that was taken by people in the EU over the conduct of the Brexit agenda. But that opens up an opportunity if we can get the right relationships. Now, as I say, it won't affect the processes, but having the right attitude from people, a positive view of Scotland, is very important. What are you able to do in that space to try and help things along?
So it's a really good example, and what Mr. Brown points to is correct, and that's my experience when meeting with European decision makers, whether in national capitals or in European institutions. There is a very strong predisposition towards Scotland as a pro-European nation, and a wish to be as helpful as they can be. And a very concrete example of where we have an opportunity to make the most of that is the energy question that I alluded to Mr. Ruskell before. I don't think it's widely reported here, but the German economy is currently going through one of its most significant transitions since the Industrial Revolution. They are moving away from a reliance on hydrocarbons, in particular Russian gas, to fuel their engineering-based economy with hydrogen. They're doing it right now. And they are unable to provide their own indigenous industry with the amount of renewable energy, whether electricity or hydrogen, that they require. So they will need to import this. And Scotland and our northern European neighbours can be a big part of their answer. And when I speak to German decision makers, as I did recently in Berlin, they are really, really keen to be able to import, to buy, so a benefit to the sector in Scotland, hydrogen and hydrogen-related products as soon as possible. To do that, we will require interconnection between Scotland and Germany, and we will require the UK government to reach regulatory agreement with the European Union relating to this. So, to Mr. Brown's point, yes, there is massive goodwill, there is massive interest. However, our relationship is not determined just by our direct contacts, and this is one of the reasons why we have a strong external affairs approach to try and maximise the opportunities that we have through the goodwill that exists to Scotland, but we still rely on a UK government who have reserved powers in relation to these energy questions to land that success for the energy transition in Scotland. So we will do everything that we can to prepare the way, to say to UK government ministers, this is a huge opportunity, please can you act? And I've impressed that on the outgoing government and will be impressing that on any potential incoming government, because the Germans are acting, regardless of what we do in Scotland and the UK. So either we can be at the forefront of this energy transition on the European continent, or we can miss the bus. And it will be decision makers in London, ultimately, who will determine whether that is the case. I wish it weren't so. I wish we would just be able to get on with it ourselves. I wish we were in the EU. I wish we were able to agree those regulations ourselves. I wish we were able to make progress on the subsea interconnection, which involves currently reserved powers. We can't. We'll do what we can, but ultimately it will be UK ministers who will determine the speed and the success of this happening. And if it fails, they will bear the responsibility for it not happening.
Yeah, that's my last question. It's worth just mentioning in passing, though, the best example of non-governmental soft power is what we're seeing just now with the Tartan Army in Germany. The reputation for Scotland is hugely boosted by their conduct. Thanks, Kavir.
Thank you, Mr Brown. I'm going to bring in Mr Bibby.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Cabinet Secretary. I want to go back to the issue of guidance and support for businesses navigating new trading arrangements and trading at all. Cabinet Secretary, you've said on a number of occasions the Scottish Government is doing everything we can. I wonder how the Scottish Government evaluates whether it is doing everything it can. You know, you mentioned support from Scottish Enterprise, from Scottish Development International, Scotland House in Brussels. How are the Scottish Government evaluating the effectiveness of the support it's given small businesses so it can back up the claim that it is doing everything it can, and what future changes will be made on the back of any evaluation?
Well, I'm at the discretion of the convener here, because I think Mr Bibby knows that we have two evidence sessions this morning, and the next evidence session relates to the government's international network and including the evaluation of that network. If the convener would wish me to do that during this part of the evidence session of this morning, I'd be happy to do so, or would we prefer to do that in the next evidence session?
I'm going to leave it to Mr Bibby to decide.
I think specifically in relation to the point about supporting small businesses to navigate the trade arrangements is very pertinent to this evidence session.
Yeah, that's fine. I'm happy to say it all twice if Mr Bibby would like me to do that. So the first thing is, in relation to the network which he described, we've got a network of government offices in 9 locations, the majority of which are in Europe. So there's Scottish government offices in terms of European Union capitals, in Dublin, in France, in Paris, in Brussels, in Berlin, and in Copenhagen. And in addition to that, there are SDI, Scottish Development International staff located throughout Europe. And they work in concert, to make sure that opportunities are pursued and that companies are supported. A very good example of that, it's a case study, one which I'll be raising in the next evidence session as well, relates to efforts in France to support Scottish exporters. And that involved both the Scottish Government office there and the SDI network working together. And the evaluation has been able to show that through one particular event alone, more than £5 million worth of export orders were secured. So, the network is working very hard to make sure that it supports businesses, small, medium and large. It's not just the Scottish Government offices. It's also the SDI network. To that, I can add the fact that there are trade envoys as well. So Madrid is an example of another European capital where we have a presence doing just that. And then in addition to that, we have the Global Scot network that feeds into this process. And in terms of the evaluation of that, there are evaluations that take place both within Scottish Enterprise, which is ultimately responsible for SDI, and the Scottish Government's network of offices also have an evaluation process. We have begun with annual reporting on that. There's already been one annual report that has been published in relation to that. One for this year is forthcoming. And when we come to talk about evaluation at more length in the next evidence session, because I know this is something that you as a committee have been looking at, I know that you took evidence in Dublin about how the Irish government does that. If there are any suggestions about how we can better supply the committee or others with information about evaluation, I'm very keen to hear that, because I think we should be rightly proud about how hard our offices and our international network works to promote exports and inward investment as well.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In terms of supporting businesses and providing guidance to them, can I ask, is the Scottish Government considering more direct intervention measures in terms of, you know, establishing a dedicated advisory board or a helpline for exporters? There's kind of some suggestions that we've had in evidence about this. You know, we've talked about supporting small business and the Scottish Government doing everything it can. Are there other measures like that that the Scottish Government's considering in terms of what more it can do to help businesses navigate the new trading range?
I and colleagues are always open to suggestions, and there is an ongoing dialogue with Scotland's business organisations, and they feedback constantly their experience about what is working well for them or is not working well for them. And if there are any gaps in that provision, I'm absolutely certain that people would be keen to hear what those are. There is dialogue, there is regular discussion about all of these things. And I very much hope that suggestions are acted on. None have been brought to my attention that have not. But if Mr. Bibby or the committee has any examples of area where there is room to improve, I think this is a good example of why inquiries like this serve the purpose of trying to make a difference where we can, notwithstanding the fact that I hope there is an appreciation that we are operating in an environment where we are in a hard Brexit environment, one that is supported by the Conservative Party and the Labour Party.
May I just come in at one moment, if that's okay? May I?
Sure.
Convener, is that okay?
Yes, Mr. Shang, yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to say a really good question about feedback, continuous improvement, and support. The best measure, of course, is sales. The best measure is outcomes. Which is why I just want to allude a bit to what the Cabinet Secretary said about Paris and St Andrew's Day activity last year, why we actually took a real effort to get feedback from all the UK UK and Scottish companies present at the MC and the work we did with the Scottish Government and SDI. And just to say that the £5 million was the firm's forecast £5 million of sales, so just to say that rather than actually secured yet. So £5 million forecast into the future. So all I'm saying is proof of the pudding is in the actual the sales. So that's what we're trying to measure more and more. Thank you.
Thank you. That's fine. Thank you.
Thank you. That's fine, Mr. Stewart. Thank you. Can I bring in Ms. Gallagher? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and officials. I would like to talk about specialised committees that have been set up to support the implementation of the UK-EU trade and cooperation agreements. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary how involved the Scottish Government has been with these committees over the last year or so?
So the first thing I would say is that there's regular dialogue between Scottish Government officials and UK Government counterparts. So this is not something which in general is something from meeting to meeting involves ministers. These are technical discussions that take place across a range of these specialist subject areas. But what I have found is that there has been an improvement in the dialogue pre-TCA meetings between myself and Now he is now no longer the Europe Minister, Leo Doherty, who I had two meetings with in relation to technical discussions around seed potatoes, around, you know, there are a number of these issues that I think the committee is very well aware of. And I think there's definitely a marked improvement in how those discussions went. So I think that reflected the fact that the discussions between officials, I think the message had been heard. There are a number of subject areas where there are technical areas where, with goodwill, one might be able to make progress. So seed potatoes, bivalve mollusks is another example, technical area where discussions have been held between officials and then between myself and ministerial opposite numbers. There were also discussions around cultural performers and the restrictions that they are facing with cabotage and such like that has made things very difficult for touring professionals. So the dialogue happens. I think in some respects it has been better than before. So there have been more meetings than there were previously. I know that some of the issues have been raised, but that is not the same thing as actually then being able to deliver on them. And that's where we discuss where there are shortcomings. So we have had issues around seed potatoes. We have had issues around bivalve mollusks. We've had issues around touring professionals. There are three very very high priority areas for us to try and get some progress on. UK government ministers have said that they've heard that they will raise them. And then we have been allowed to view discussions with the European Union, not allowed to take part in them ourselves, where UK government ministers have raised issues. But to date, on those specific examples, we haven't yet got the outcomes that we are looking for. But in terms of a system, there is a system. It does bring our officials together. It does bring ministers together now. But we really need to look at outcomes and not just processes. The processes are better than they were. That is definitely the case. And there is still significant room for improvement. But you know, when we're looking at outcomes, there is still some way to go.
Thank you very much for that answer, Cabinet Secretary. The reason that I'm reasoning it is because within the letter that you sent through to the convener and committee before the meeting today, you stress within the letter that it's one of the primary opportunities to influence the implementation of the TCA through these committees. But I maybe question the frequency of them, because 17 out of 18 of them met once in 2023, and then you had the Fisheries SCA meet twice. So do you think these meetings could be more frequent, or is it, you know, on a case-by-case basis?
So, well, there's a number of things about them. They are, so the first thing to say is they're all relatively new. So some of them have been set up later than others. I'm not in a position, I'm looking to my officials to see whether they have a particular view on whether the frequency of the meetings has been problematic. I think the challenge, to be honest, was seeing them established in the first place. And now that they have largely been established, I think they have to find a rhythm to what they do. I'm not in favour of having meetings for meetings' sake. I generally believe if there are issues that need to be discussed, that then they should be raised. And so maybe there's an issue around how often. I think that's another of what Ms. Gallagher's question is. Are they meeting often enough?
Yes.
I'm not sure if we're going to be able to answer that yet. I see Nick's hands up. He can come back in a second. I think my concern, if there was a concern that I had, was more around the fact that a significant number for quite some time had not met at all. And if it was thought that it was important to establish these, then it seemed to me pretty important that they should at least have an initial meeting and then discuss what the rhythm should be of them meeting in future. Now that we're at a stage where they have largely been established, I think we're in the next stage of working out whether they are actually meeting as often as they should. So it's definitely the right question. I don't have the answer to that in the round, Ms. Gallagher, but I'm as keen to know as she is as to whether that is indeed the case. But I think that that's something that's going to be becoming more apparent after they have now initially met. Nick, you had a hand up about some additional information, perhaps.
Mr. Leek there?
You're still muted.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you. That's absolutely right. The relationship has the UK-EU relationship has improved, and that means that these structures that should have been set up earlier under the TCA are starting to function properly. What I would say is that kind of the theory is that the Partnership Council tells the specialised committees what to do. So if there's a particular area which is a focus for the Partnership Council, then it would make sense for that specialised committee perhaps to meet more often than some of the others. I just think setting up these meetings it doesn't replicate going to the working groups, but it establishes contacts and relationships between experts in the administrations, and that's going to be really important to delivering outcomes in the future. But it will take time to function properly. Frank wants to come in as well.
May I just very briefly, as with alignment, it's quality, not quantity.
Yeah.
So what worries me about infrequent specialised committees, and I don't really have a view on frequency, but is that the work is done between rather than at. The work is done in the corridors. So it's really important for us that the forums at which we can be present are of a high quality rather than quantity, see what I'm saying? So that things aren't stitched up in advance. So for us, it's really, yeah, so that's the question for me. Are there real issues coming to those committee meetings, or is it happening elsewhere, the actual discussion?
That's really helpful. All. Thank you very much for that. And I don't have any further questions, convener. Thank you.
I'm looking to see if there are further questions from the committee. I wonder if I could finish, Cabinet Secretary, with coming back on a few of the points we've covered already. You talked about the offer from the Commission about youth mobility, and I think it's always worth emphasising that in European terms that means under 30s, so it's a big offer to the UK about mobility of young people and the opportunities so important for education but also for other areas. And there is, you know, you've expressed that you hope that that will be revisited after this. But I think it'd be remiss of us, given our full title in the Parliament, not to examine the culture sector and the problems for touring artists, particularly because of our traditional artists and those who want to go to Europe and are now finding it prohibitively expensive and losing out on bookings across Europe. So could you just give a little bit more information about what Creative Europe membership would mean for our artists if that were to happen? And would that solve the issue for our touring artists?
I think Creative Europe is much more programme oriented. So it's not the same as restoring mobility for all young people, which would include all younger people who are interested in the creative pursuits. And so I think we need to appreciate that being part of Creative Europe is viewed as being very important within the creative and arts community, the established creative and arts world. But wider mobility is the big prize for all young people. So from those who are just curious to travel to live, learn, experience, but then in that wider sense, just fundamentally eases the issues for our younger, particularly our breakthrough artists, for whom being able to travel and tour in Europe, mainland Europe, was always seen as an essential part of their career development, where many have reported back that they aren't able to do so or the costs are prohibitive, where the opportunity of free mobility would just ease their chances of career development. So the prize is there. And the good news is that the offer is still there. The offer is there for both. I know I went to the Commission. I asked. They said, this is not one of those areas where the UK saying they would wish to be part of these programmes, like Horizon, would not be viewed as cherry-picking. So even if, and I would wish it to be otherwise, but even if the UK was to remain outside the European single market, outside the European Union proper, being part of Creative Europe, being part of a mobility agreement is something that is on the table, and I think it should be grabbed with both hands.
Thank you. That is very helpful, Cabinet Secretary. The final question is that the review of the TCA takes place, as you said, in 2026. So this is indeed a timely inquiry. But given the current UK-EU trading environment, what do you think might be the challenges in the next 2 years facing our small businesses and SMEs trading in Europe?
Well, everything that we've learnt thus far, because the big picture is not going to change as far as I'm aware. There is no difference. There is no substantive difference between either of the main UK political parties stand in the current general election in relationship to the European Union. Neither of them are suggesting that there should be a rejoining of the European single market. Neither of them are suggesting rejoining the European Union. That means that hard Brexit remains just that. So to small and medium-sized businesses, to all Scottish exporters, there needs to be an understanding that the big picture does not change with pro-Brexit British government. And the Scottish government will do what it can at the margins, because that is the only area where one can have an influence on being outside the single market and having this hard Brexit arrangement. Now, we will beat the drum. We will make the case. But the facts will still remain so under a Conservative government or a Labour government, that the UK and Scotland as part of it, regardless of the fact we didn't want it to happen, are having hard Brexit done unto us, and the damage to our economy, the damage to our exports, will unfortunately remain in place. I would wish it to be otherwise. There is another option, of course, which is rejoin the European Union. That is still a debate in Scotland. I'm sorry, it's not in amongst the UK parties, but in Scotland, it is still the position of the Scottish government that we would wish to rejoin the European Union as a member state, and that would obviate all of these issues.
Yeah, thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. I think it's also worth noting that as myself and Deputy Convener, not the current Deputy Convener, Donald Cameron, have attended frequent PPA meetings, and the priorities of the PPA, which of course the Westminster and Lords link with European, not the Commission, with the European Parliament and the MEPs, a lot of the priorities that have been talked about are the priorities of the PPA as well, and frequently come up, such as SPS, such as youth mobility, such as carbon trading and security. I think there is a shared interest across the UK, if not been shown by the governments at the moment, and their priorities being set with the Commission. So thank you for your attendance on this issue. We're going to suspend for about 5 minutes, and then we'll come back on our next agenda item. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Welcome back. We move to our fourth agenda item, which is on national outcomes, and it's to take evidence from the committee's inquiry on the Scottish Government's national outcomes and indicators relating to international policy. And we're joined again by Angus Robertson, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And he is joined by officials Russell Bain, Deputy Director of International Futures and Brand Scotland Policy, and Craig Thompson, Team Leader Working Internationally, Scottish Government. And can I invite again the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement.
Very good morning again, Convener and Committee Members, and I'm delighted to be able to speak to you again this morning, this time about outcomes of our international work. This is the first opportunity that we've had to talk in this space since the publication of the first annual report on Scotland's international network in December 2023. That publication was, of course, in following a recommendation of your committee, which I was glad to accept. And I'd be pleased to hear feedback from members on how that report met your aspirations and what you'd like to see more of in the future. Officials in the network offices back home in Scotland are right now in the midst of undertaking the monitoring and evaluation work to inform our next annual report, which we'll publish later this year. And I want to continue to refine and improve that report. It's an important part of how we ensure accountability and transparency around how Scotland's international network delivers. I believe the network makes a very significant contribution on behalf of Scottish business and organisations and in support of Scottish interests. The most recent EY investment attractiveness survey showed that for the eighth consecutive year, Scotland has been the most attractive destination for foreign investment in the UK outside London. That's in large part due to the excellent effort of officials in Scottish Development International, Scottish Government and partner bodies at home and overseas that promote Scotland in the world. In relation to the review of the national outcomes, the Scottish Government has now laid its report before Parliament. I'm pleased that the international outcome remains in the proposed set of outcomes, albeit with a slight shift in focus. The slight changes proposed relate to the twin crises of the climate and biodiversity emergencies. The word globally replaces the word internationally, reflecting that it is an outcome not just between nations, but in relation to the land, the sea and the air that we all share. And the words show leadership are added in recognition that Scotland has much to offer partners across the world in the transition to a greener, growing, fairer economy. Members of the committee are likely to recognise that there is a current indicator on international networks in the set informing the current international outcome, which has not had any data published. The committee has heard from a variety of expert witnesses that this sort of quantitative analysis of diplomatic activity, networking, building relationships, exercising influence, deploying soft power is very difficult, and that countries the world over with much larger international footprints than Scotland have a challenge doing that, and we will do our best to capture that. I believe, for example, Professor Juliet Carbo of the University of Edinburgh and Professor Stephen Gethins of St Andrews University, amongst others, have given evidence to that effect. That's been our experience too, drawing together data that meets the analytical rigour needed for the National Performance Framework. And knowing that to be the case, there is an opportunity for us to do more on presenting and highlighting qualitative data in a different format to demonstrate the impact of our international work. We published just earlier this week a significant report looking at our contribution to international development over 2021 to 2023. The annual report on the international network is another excellent example of this, and I look forward to presenting the next iteration later this year. It will lay the groundwork for future annual reporting on Scotland's international strategy, taking a similar approach across the wider sweep of our international activity. And this way we can balance strong performance on hard measures, particularly in the economic space, with a narrative element on how the work of diplomats and trade and investment experts helps us to meet our objectives and to deliver impact at home. I know the committee was able to visit Ireland to learn how they approach similar questions, and I'm pleased that our team of the Scottish Government civil servants based in the British Embassy in Dublin were able to host and facilitate your engagement with the Department of Foreign Affairs in Dublin. The committee, of course, also heard from the heads of three of our international offices last year, and I hope there are more opportunities like this to share how our international activity contributes towards achieving outcomes for Scotland. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. If I could open with a question about the groundbreaking policy of reparation that the Scottish Government has put in place in terms of climate, and how that is been long asked for from the Global South and NGOs, but Scotland being one of the first countries, or the first country, to actually include reparation. Is there a measurement for that, and how is the impact of that money being assessed going forward?
Good morning to committee, good morning to my officials that are joining on the call. The issues of reparations in relation to climate change is very much at the start of discourse, and we're very much at the beginnings of a discussion about the relationship of the developed world to the developing world, in particular those parts of the globe that are already seeing catastrophic climatic change that would include very low-lying countries, particularly in the Pacific. So we're right at the start of a process here, and you know, obviously this is something that we are going to be having further discussions with. I think committee members will be aware that Scotland is a co-chair of the Under 2 Coalition, which brings together sub-state governments from around the world. That is one of the forums where we work with other governments to work out how we could best coordinate our domestic activities. But I'm sure that the issue of our relationship with parts of the world which are facing the catastrophic effects of climatic change are going to play an ever greater role. And I'm happy to ask my officials to update committee on what these very initial steps are. I think we've got a long way to go on it.
Thank you. And you mentioned our committee visit to Dublin, which we all found very, very informative, and were able to see how they are playing to their strengths in terms of image, reputation, and drawing on the energy and enthusiasm of their diaspora. So I was wondering, in the revised national outcome, what draws on the experience of other small countries, although very enviously they were opening, their 131st mission, and very much concentrating on the African continent recently. So what lessons can we learn from somewhere like Ireland, albeit as an independent nation there?
Yeah, well, I think you've pointed to one of the areas where I think there are a lot of learnings that we can take, which relates to Ireland and its diaspora. Ireland has a very large diaspora, so has Scotland. But for decades, Ireland has been pursuing a focused diaspora policy, with a dedicated minister, it's a policy priority, not just for the Department of Foreign Affairs, but others within the Irish government, to do as much as it can to develop and support the Irish diaspora, but then also use it as part of its mission to improving Ireland's exports and inward investment. And that has been a significant influence on our Scottish Connections framework, which is a relatively new strategy, which is our approach to diaspora. One of the lessons that we have taken on board, and this is a consideration in Ireland as much as it is in any other countries that takes diaspora seriously, is that the nature of diaspora is changing. So not only do we have the significant historic and heritage diaspora that we know about, particularly in the Anglosphere of the United States of America, of Canada, of Australia, of New Zealand, But there are other aspects of Scotland's relationship with the world which has not received as much attention and certainly should be now. So diaspora, if you look at, and I would recommend if committee members have not looked at the connections framework, is embracing a much wider understanding of what diaspora is. Yes, people who have hailed historically from Scotland in one way or another, but people whose connection to Scotland might be very current. They may have studied here, they may have lived here, they may just like here, or they may have just discovered that they have a connection to Scotland. One of those areas, which is relatively new, is an understanding, for example, that a significant number of African Americans are of Scottish heritage. And this year in Tartan Day, in both Washington DC and in New York City, I undertook a large number of events and met with a large number of people in relation to this as a new initiative in relation to Scotland's diaspora. So going back to your initial question, what can we learn from a country like Ireland? We have learned that taking diaspora seriously is a good thing to do. We are doing it. We have published for the first time two resources which did not exist before. They are available through Scotland's digital shopfront at www.scotland.org. One is able to register as part of the diaspora organisations, Scottish organisations around the world. And secondly, if one lives outside Scotland and would want to remain connected, one can as an individual sign up to be part of that online diaspora connection. In addition to that, our international network, so our 9 international offices, but wider than that, through our SDI network, through our trade envoys, through our Global Scot network, diaspora is also forming a part of work that was not the case before as well. So it's a really good example of where we can learn from best practice. Ireland has taken it very seriously for a long time. We are taking it seriously now. And we are going to reach out as well as we can, both to the historic and heritage diaspora, but to that wider diaspora, which includes, amongst other things, tens of thousands now of students from other countries that have studied in Scotland. Those would include thousands of students in China, for example, who are part of Scotland's wider diaspora now as well.
Okay. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to move to questions from the committee. I'm going to bring Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener and Cabinet Secretary. The international development policy has really showed some real opportunities, Cabinet Secretary, and the idea about trying to manage that, we talk about the soft power that we have as well as the hard power that we've got in managing that process. But there is an area that we can think about how we develop that and how we extend the development goals which have informed the refreshment of the national performance framework. So where does that balance, where does that sit in ensuring that we do have that policy and that does develop within the national performance framework?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. I think that's a very encouraging question. On international development, we have now, I think I'm right in saying we're coming towards an important anniversary of Scotland's international development work, which goes back to the beginnings of devolution, which I think I'm right in saying has cross-party support. It is by international development standards, it is not huge, but it is significant in reflecting the values that we all share, and also is very focused in particular countries where we have a historic connection with. These are areas where, in largest part, the work relates to devolved responsibilities. So on health, on education, we are doing quite a lot of work in relation to supporting the role of women. We've been supporting a number of projects specifically in that sphere. So that might be an area that Mr. Stewart's alluding to in terms of extending development goals. is saying that this, so the idea of a feminist foreign policy, as it's been described and is being pursued by a number of countries, and Scotland's working with others to identify how can we do that. But as I mentioned in my opening remarks, we've just seen the publication of a very significant document around Scotland's international development. And I think there's a lot of evidence there to show the good work which has been undertaken. So given that I know part of the consideration of the committee here today is around evaluation, I'd be very keen to know whether you as deputy convener and other colleagues look at the likes of that report and are satisfied that that is providing you with the information that you require, both about what's been delivered, but also about what the reporting mechanism is. Is this happening in a way which you think is optimal for your job? You're there to make sure that the Scottish Government, its agencies, its policies and so on are being delivered optimally. And I'm keen to know whether you feel that you're being well served. I want to be an ally of the committee here and make sure that we are providing things in the format which is of best use for you. So we've just had that on international development. We're going to have an updated report on the international network. Similarly, is this capturing what you require? And no doubt we will learn that from the conclusions of your deliberations. But you know, we are providing very significant documents which are reporting on what is the policy, how is it being conducted, and where, as Mr. Stewart has alluded to, where there is an extension of goals, is that being properly reflected and reported on? I'd be keen to hear from the committee. I feel it is, but is there more that we can do? And if there is, I'm very keen that we do that.
I mean, the evaluation is vitally important to see exactly what we're achieving, and I think you've alluded to that, Cabinet Secretary. Mm-hmm. But it's how we actually also manage to engage with civil society to ensure that they feel part of that equation as well. Yes, you've itemised and you've given us a strategy that we have and the policy that we have and the format, but we have to make sure that there's engagement, there's participation, there is process, so that at the end of the day we are then achieving what we set out to achieve.
Yes.
And I think there are elements of that that still need to be clarified and still need to be adapted, but as a member of this committee I do think we are trying to manage that process in a relatively good way at this stage.
I agree. Only last week I met with Scotland's leading international development organisations to hear from them about how is the Scottish Government's policy and its funding working from their point of view, to hear what they have been working on, what they intend to work on in future, and how they would like to see things develop. I should say that that included colleagues joining from our partner countries. So it's not just about civil society in Scotland, it's also about civil society in the countries where we operate. And I think it's hugely important that this is a two-way process, because this is not just about how Scotland can help our partner nations like Malawi, Rwanda, Zaire, and so on. It is about what is it that we can be learning from there as well, and that's something that I'm very open to. It's something that happened only last week. It's something that we will be continuing to do.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. I think Mr. Robertson, it's worth noting that in all of these areas that the clerks have been working very closely with your officials to try and improve the reporting mechanism and ensure that we're aligned in what's happening. And I would like to thank both your officials and my clerks for that work that's been ongoing. I would also say, as convener, I certainly welcome the move away from sort of crude measurements such as GDP towards well-being and, you know, and as you say, feminist foreign policy, all of these aspects of how we can do things differently, I think is really, really important. One of the comments we did have in evidence was from Oxfam, who, in also welcoming that move away from crude measures, I think as stakeholders, they would still like to see how that translates into policy and spending decisions and the budget part of what happens in international development. And I wonder if that's something that you are considering going forward.
And I'm always open to suggestions about how we can make sure that there's the best understanding of decision-making and priorities. I'm pleased that people are wanting us to do more. That's a good thing. That is a reflection of the fact that people think that even although, and we have a relatively small budget compared to other international development partners, people feel that Scotland's input is welcomed. And, you know, I know that, for example, we've got the Zambian president in Scotland at the present time. Sorry, I think I said Zaire a moment ago. I mean, say Zambia. We've got the Zambian president here at the present time, and we have projects in that country. And we know from him, we know from his government, we know from civil society partners in that country, as we do from our other partner countries, that Scotland's contribution is valued. But along the way, I think having that good relationship with our partners and explaining how we make the decisions that we do is an integral part of maintaining that high level of trust and welcome for engagement. And that is something that we are keen to maintain with our charity and third sector partners, but also our partner countries as well. And I think that the fact that we've got government relations and we've got government visitors here from those countries, as well as an ongoing relationship with the third sector in those countries, is proof of things working.
Okay. That's great. Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, I mean, just following on from that, we had Scotland's International Development Alliance in committee last month, and the comment they made is we cannot have well-being in Scotland at the expense of communities in other countries, so we're keen to see that reflected across the whole of the national outcomes. So I suppose the question, Cabinet Secretary, about how you kind of get this out of the silo and ensure that all of your colleagues across the Cabinet are actually taking these really important questions about well-being and impact on the world, and particularly the Global South, kind of seriously, to the point that it's really embedded in their work on, you know, economic growth, prosperity, everything else. And a question about who kind of leads on that. So what does that conversation with you and your officials look like with other parts of government who, you know, probably have as much of an impact in terms of the well-being of the Global South as anything that you can do with your officials in your own department with your own quite limited budgets?
Yeah. Well, it's a very well-timed question because, as Mr. Ruskell knows, I have now taken on the day-to-day ministerial responsibility for international development, which up until recently was held by other colleagues. So I think his intervention is very well-timed to make sure, as I begin acting on those responsibilities in a day-to-day way, that I think about how do we help mainstream, to use a jargon, how we mainstream an understanding of what it is that we do, how we're doing it, and how this isn't just something that sits in a box called international development or within the Department of External Affairs of the Scottish Government, that it is something that impacts in the broader work of the Scottish Government. I have to say that we have had significant buy-in from other ministers at other parts of government in relation to the well-being agenda, something that Mr. Ruskell highlighted. But then how do we link that to what we're doing Firth of Scotland? One of those areas where we are trying to be joined up in this relates to our immediate northern neighbourhood. So we've been talking a bit about international development and a relationship with the Global South. We also have a view towards the Global North and our immediate neighbourhood. And there's a very strong environmental dimension to this. Scotland's the most northerly non-Arctic country in the world. And we're doing a lot to work with our northern neighbours to deal with the shared challenges that we have in terms of the environment, but also in areas where the Scottish Government has devolved responsibility, and well-being is one of those areas. And through our approach to Arctic and Northern cooperation. We are bringing together Scottish universities, for example, to work with other northern seats of learning to make sure that we are doing everything that we can in the field of remote health, of well-being and education, to make sure that we can be cooperating with one another there. And that's something that involves much more than just the Department of External Affairs within the Scottish Government. So I suppose that's an example where it's not just myself, but we will have ministers that have responsibility for areas like the environment or energy or health and so on, who are part of that wider Scottish Government approach to things. So I suppose the short answer to Mr. Ruskell is I will reflect on his international development point and how we make sure that has more wider understanding across Scottish Government. In an area where I have had responsibility for a longer period in terms of day-to-day, I know that that's something that we have been doing already when looking at our northern neighbourhood, but I want to make sure that we're doing that with both.
Yeah, I mean, there's always good examples that can be found of government working with neighbours. I'm aware of many of those. But I suppose fundamentally it's a question of, like, who is sitting on top of the sustainable development goals in the Cabinet and ensuring that government policy is aligned with that, and how is that then reflected in the national outcomes? And I'm just not really clear whether that's yourself, Cabinet Secretary, or whether it's the First Minister, or whether it's the whole of Cabinet, or nobody specifically in Cabinet, but everybody's got a bit of it. I mean, it feels like, you know, the national outcomes are important. The sustainable development goals have been there for decades. They're massively important if we're to move in the right direction as a society and take and work with the rest of the globe on those outcomes. So, I guess who's in control of it, really? Who's monitoring it? Yeah. Is that yourself, or is that someone else in Cabinet? Who would you speak to if there was a question on sustainable development goals?
So, I mean, I think ultimately a responsibility for the Scottish Government lies with the First Minister in terms of an all-government responsibility. But in relation to our external affairs, so sustainable development goals emerge from the United Nations, as I think everybody knows. So that's an external affairs area of responsibility. But I think Mr. Ruskell has been making the point that this cannot sit just within one silo. So it has to be seen right across government. So again, I think his question, the timing of his question is very good for me to underline next steps in terms of reflecting on how do we capture all of that in our reporting to make sure that any doubts that Mr. Ruskell might have about this being something that is seen only in silo terms is much more generally understood, because it cannot, for very obvious reasons, just be seen in or understood in one part of government.
So if you got the dashboard, if you got the Sustainable Development Goals dashboard, and you're sitting there and you're able to understand how different parts of government are meeting those Sustainable Development Goals or not meeting them or could do better, it's about oversight. Who's in front of that? Who's got the overview about what's going on across government? Is it yourself or is it somebody else?
Well, I think we're all involved in one way or another. As Mr. Ruskell knows, in government there's no shortage of meetings and there's no shortage of dashboards around where are we with things. In relation to the United Nations specifically, Scottish Government ministers have taken part in United Nations events and will continue to do so. And we are part of multilateral efforts to make sure that we are upholding the likes of the Sustainable Development Goals. And this is something that there is a responsibility for across government. I suppose the point I'm trying to make it is not owned by just one part of government, i.e. the Department of External Affairs. It's one that is reflected across government. But let me perhaps write to Mr. Ruskell through you, convener, to give a fuller answer about that, because I think he's quite right to be asking for more detail, and I'm happy to provide that.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay.
Mr. Brown?
Yep.
Thanks very much. We had a discussion earlier on about the Irish way of dealing with these things, and I just wonder, maybe it's a wee bit naive, but having observed the Irish for many years and the way they go about things, certainly within the EU, but also more widely globally, they tend to work as a Team Ireland in a very disciplined way, and that's across parties and across different tiers of government and elected representation. If you see them, even in different parties, they will pick a number of limited gains that they can achieve. They tend not to make any enemies and not to get involved in some of the big bun fights in the EU, and have been very successful in doing that. I just wonder whether the Cabinet Secretary thinks that there's any potential for, it would probably have to come at the end of a term or at the start of a new term, for cross-party agreement in terms of international representation, the stance that's taken being, if you like, a Team Scotland stance. Complicated, of course, by the unresolved constitutional question, but it must still be possible to achieve that. And if it was to be the case, it would probably need whoever was in government at the time to lead that. I just wonder if he thinks there's any merit in trying to pursue that.
So I think Ireland definitely benefits from having a strong, unified, non-partisan approach to the promotion of Ireland internationally. There are things that they do which are so much further ahead of where Scotland is within a devolved context. So if one takes their international network, for example, at scale, it is, you know, by significantly factors larger than Scotland, so is able to deliver significantly more than we are able to. But if you take their efforts promoting Ireland in and around St. Patrick's Day alone, they literally dispatched the entire Irish government around the world, including to Edinburgh, to promote Ireland at events. And up until now, unfortunately, there has not always been consensus about whether the Scottish government should be promoting Scotland at all. And unfortunately, there have been political actors that would seek to criticise any form of international promotion or engagement. And I think that is to the detriment of Scotland, because notwithstanding the difference of views around Scotland's constitutional future, if we look at what actually happens when we're talking about the promotion of Scotland internationally, it is about exports, inward investment, tourism, education, culture, all of that which fits under the Brand Scotland umbrella, again, something which should have cross-party agreement and support. For those unaware of it, Brand Scotland, which has been operating since 2018, brings together our national agencies in a way that other countries are very jealous of, to promote Scotland internationally. So there are some things that we do very well, and that there should be cross-party agreement around the promotion of, and I would hope that there is. Our international networks have been supported by different parties. The Scotland House in Brussels was established under the Conservatives, and other parts of the network were established during the first terms of the Scottish Parliament, and have been built on since 2007, obviously by the current administration. But, you know, other different parties have been involved in developing Scotland's international network over the past. And I think one of the lessons from Ireland is having wider and broader support of promotional efforts is a good thing. But again, without wanting to be too self-critical, if I look at Tartan Day, Tartan Week as an example, there has been, for the last, since its inception, a cross-party Scottish Parliament delegation that has taken part in that. The presiding officer goes and represents the whole Parliament. In recent years, we've even seen the UK government begin to show an interest in Tartan Day and Tartan Day events. So with a bit of luck, I think we're hopefully building some consensus around why Scotland's promotion internationally is a good thing. And I would observe that even on this committee, I think it's before Mr. Brown's time on the committee, I was being encouraged by colleagues on the committee. In fact, it was the outgoing deputy convener of the committee who was suggesting that the Scottish Government's international network should be enlarged and include countries in South America. So I think there is an ambition there. And if there's anything that I can do to encourage colleagues across the parties to support the international network, to support international promotion, to support our work with the diaspora, I would be very keen to work with colleagues on a non-partisan basis to make that happen.
Are there any further questions from the committee? No, I think that's exhausted questions this morning, Cabinet Secretary. Can I thank you again and your officials for attendance at committee this morning. This is our final meeting before summer recess. I thank all members and officials and advisers for their hard work in what has been a busy year for us. And I hope that everyone manages to have a well-deserved break over the summer. And I look forward to seeing you all again in September. Thank you very much. I'll close this meeting.